welcome to Leaders of Tomorrow, the only daily enabling platform for small businesses. Over the past 7 years, we've understood what matters the most to you, the entrepreneur. And in year 8, we're bringing you two of your most pressing concerns, that are funding and mentoring. I'm Sunanda Jayaseelan. On tonight's show, we're bringing you a masterclass on family-run businesses. In this exclusive sit-down interview with the joint directors of Emami, I spoke to them about why innovation is so crucial when it comes to the FMCG industry. I also asked them how they're working so seamlessly under one roof when it comes to both business families, and their tips, tricks, advice, and suggestions for family-run businesses. Take a listen to a slice of that conversation. Aditya Manish, thank you very much for taking the time to join us here on the Leaders of Tomorrow. It's such a pleasure to be able to speak to people like yourself and companies like yourselves, which essentially embody what entrepreneurship is all about. So today's episode really is a masterclass of sorts in a nutshell for our entrepreneurs. So it's exciting to be speaking to the both of you. I want to start by talking really about the fact that Emami is known as a business that has now, over the generations, ensured that both sides of the families, the Agarwals and the Goenkas, are working together simultaneously, taking the business forward. 9 members now, I understand, of the original founding families actively involved in the business, but that has really taken quite a bit of planning and execution. Before we come to the planning and execution, to the both of you, what would you like our viewers to really know about the Emami story? Maybe one or two highlights that you want to start with.
First of all, thank you very much for inviting us here and for giving us a chance to talk about Emami. See, Emami is, people say that it's two families, but it's actually not two families, it's one now. Just the surnames are different.
Sure.
And sometimes people don't know.
Biologically two different, but yeah, professionally now one. Yeah,
so,
sure.
So people, sometimes they don't understand who is a Goenka, who is a Agarwal.
Okay.
And we take pride in that. And that's our strength. And that is what we believe has taken us, brought us here, and will take us further.
I want to talk about the fact that you have an existing family council, which essentially takes care of all, you know, say, future growth plans, disagreements perhaps, and really rules and governs really what is happening at the family business. If you can break that down for our viewers to explain to them how exactly it works, what you want them to know about how it works.
Yeah, you see, what we have done is, in the family council, we all family members are there. Then we have few senior people of the group there also who are part of the council. We have few outside consultants also who have been associated with us for a very long time. So we all form a part of this family council, and we sit twice in a month, and then we discuss all issues of various business and where we need to take what business ahead or whatever, wherever we need to invest. So all discussions happen in that family council, and that's how, and that's the place where we take decisions.
Okay.
Our parents, Mr. Agarwal, Mr. Goenka, both have been very progressive in the thought process, in their actions. And in spite of we being such a large family, and there are rules also for each one of us to follow. But in spite of these rules, there is the best part is there is enough freedom of thought, expression, and action. And more so, over these rules and these are more, they work more as guidelines.
Sure.
Rather than railings.
Okay.
So it's so flexible, yet it gives you only a little to move here and there. But so we have become so happy with each other. And that is why, because of their progressiveness, they could form these councils even when the company was very small.
Sure.
They could see how to progress and how to take it forward to the next level.
Okay.
And these are the reasons why. Okay.
And you see, this council is not involved in day-to-day working of different companies.
Okay, I was just going to come to that.
Yeah, so you see, all companies are being headed by professional CEOs, and say family members are responsible for particular companies. So only the matters goes to family council where we need a major expansion, a major takeover, or some strategic investments and all. Otherwise, day-to-day working is being handled by companies individually.
So you were saying something interesting earlier that, you know, there are rules and regulations that have been set, although you do have the freedom to make decisions in some sense. Business is so dynamic. The business environment is so dynamic. Things are changing every day as we speak. How do we ensure then that those rules and regulations perhaps are also changing with the dynamics and the realities really of business?
So as I said, that the founders are very progressive. And at the same time, the rules are flexible as well.
Sure.
So, and it acts more as a guideline, just to guide you, not to bind you. So that is why we have been evolving. And that is why you will see, if you see the history of Emami, sure, how we have changed. And we have worked with the best of consultants, starting from EY to maybe McKinsey and BCG.
Sure.
We have worked with the best of film directors, best of film producers. This we have been able to do not only because we had the money, but also because we wanted to do the best. And best only you can do if you're changing with time. So I think it's actually not a challenge at all.
Okay, so you have guidelines, but you're also keeping, of course, all thoughts and opinions open. So you're listening to all the changes.
So yeah, if I may also say that the things which are good, those should be written in rock.
Okay.
That should not change. Sure. Things which are not good, that should be fluid. It can change.
Okay.
See, when we were very small, when they started, so we started working with best of the people of industry from that time. So they were always very forward looking. You see, Mr. Alec Padamsi,
sure,
he, I think he was associated with us for more than 20 years.
Sure.
So 20 years back, our company was very small. At that time, for our size of company, it would have been difficult to even work with them.
And getting them to Calcutta.
Yeah.
Sure, yeah.
So they were very, very, very forward-looking and always wanted to work with the best of the people, irrespective of how big or small we are.
So okay, when we meet so many people, we get new ideas, we also change ourselves.
Okay. So your advice then for entrepreneurs who are watching this interview to say, if you're in a family-run business where you have two or three generations who are still actively involved in the business, what should you do?
Number one, I would say that there is a difference between ownership and management.
Okay.
We should understand that. We may be owners, but when you're in the office, you are a manager there. Number one. Number two, you should work like as if you are a custodian of your family council there.
Sure.
And number three, rules are there. Rules are for everyone. Rules are not to stop you from working, but to help you from doing things. So rules should always change, keep on changing. We should not think I am the owner, so the rules are not for me.
Yeah, and you see, when you are working together in a family business, you need to understand that trust is very important. That trust part, that's the key, and the communication, that is very key. That whatever, you know, as you asked earlier also, there are two families working together. If communication and trust is there, then I think there's not much issues. You
okay
can easily work with anyone.
Okay.
And there will be not much issues. And issues are there, as I said earlier, also in all relationships.
Okay. I'm sure this next question you've handled very many times in the past. But the question as far as succession is concerned. And this obviously comes up to the family council very often. How do you handle those questions? What would you have to say to our viewers about
that? We are fortunate that this succession question doesn't come to us.
Okay.
It comes to our parents.
So as a first, if you're taking this question on for the first time then, what would you have to say?
As I said, management and ownership.
Sure.
So as successors, the ownership transfers.
Okay.
But as managers, it depends upon your upon how you work, upon the quality of work you give to the organization. Mm-hmm. If you're not a good manager, you have to opt out.
Okay.
And you see, here succession, fortunately, in our case, we are a very diversified group. So what happens is we family members are responsible for certain companies.
Sure.
Like both of us work together, so we are responsible for 2-3 companies. His younger brother, my elder brother, they are responsible for a few companies. Then his sister and my cousins, they are responsible for certain companies. So individually, they are looking after the company. But when a collective decision needs to be taken, then the family council comes into the play.
Okay.
So right now, his father and my father are at the helm of the affairs. Then in future, as I said, for individual companies, the individual person would be responsible.
Sure.
And then for the group decision, this council will come into play.
Okay, fair enough. Let's also talk about how the landscape is changing as far as Kolkata, as the city is perceived. most of your businesses are, you know, tend to be headquartered out of, say, Mumbai, Delhi, etc. For a business that was started here and has been so successful here, what perhaps have been some of the best opportunities that Kolkata has thrown up for both of you, for Emami as a group? What would you like to tell our viewers about that?
It's a huge advantage to us that, as you mentioned, most of the companies are based out of Bombay, Bangalore, Delhi.
Yeah.
So that turns out to be an advantage for us, because then we become a very important choice for people living here.
Sure.
Number one. Number two, Bengal, as you may be knowing since the very beginning, it has, the people here have been very progressive and educated and creative.
Sure.
Our business is a lot about creative and also working with their hearts.
Yeah.
And nowadays it is not, we are not seeing any problem in getting people also from the other parts of the country, or for that matter from other part of the globe. People are willing to stay here. City is good. It has everything to offer what any other city has to offer. Maybe some things are much more better than any other city. So people are happy working with us here.
It's time for a quick break, but we'll continue bringing you this masterclass on family-run businesses on the other side. Just stay tuned. Welcome back. You're with us here on Leaders of Tomorrow. Tonight, Emami is our masterclass when it comes to family-run businesses. Listening to a slice of that conversation that I did with the joint directors of the company at the headquarters in Kolkata. Speaking of people, two things. First is the aspect of promoters versus professional managers. A lot of business families are doing that. A lot of small businesses are doing that. Is that something that you would actively encourage for an SME watching this interview to go down the route of?
You see, professionals looking after the business really helps the promoters also. You see, they can then concentrate into expanding into other areas, and it really gives them time to give a thought on anything new.
Sure.
So making a company professionalism, it really helps. And we have seen that, as I said, when they started with Emami Limited with few products, and in the span of say 40 years where they have taken the group to, and it has been possible, professionalism has really helped us to take the company and group to this level.
Sure. Then for businesses that are saying we don't want to let go of control, how have you managed to work that out at Emami?
It's not about control. By working there, you're not actually wanting to control it. You should be able to contribute. So control is a very negative word here.
Okay.
And people don't like control. People like freedom to work so that they can contribute. So if you are wanting to control them, then they will be happy doing what you want them to do. But actually you get good people to let them do what they should do.
And you know, if good people are working for you, it's never like leaving the control of the company. It's always, if you are a promoter, you would always want your company to do well. Whether if a professional is being able to do that in a better manner than you, it's always, it's our company. So
you focus on growth.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
It's nothing like losing control of the company.
Sure. Fair enough. And now, even as you're talking of the legacy of the Emami Group, I want to talk about the way forward and looking forward. If one of you or one of your children who's involved in the business wants to be involved in something different, wants to do something different, wants to, you know, expand or go entirely out into a separate branch, you know, your advice about how perhaps you'd handle that situation, is that something that you would look at? You know, how do you look at innovation? What does that mean for you?
So till now, we have not faced this situation. Maybe when the third generation joins, which will be too soon, maybe they would like to branch out. I think, though we have not decided in the council, but I think whenever it will come up, we'll be more than happy to support him in our own way, and also let him fly and at least have a feel of the world.
Yeah, and our guidance will always be there. We would be, in fact, happy if somebody, youngsters, comes up with an idea and he wants to do something new. And you see, we have become so diversified by doing new things only. So if one of the youngsters would like to do something new, we would welcome it.
So then the big picture as far as innovation is concerned, and we love asking everyone who comes on, the leaders of tomorrow, about their own approach to innovation. How do you view, how do you approach innovation at Emami? How do you encourage innovation at Emami?
You see, we have always believed in innovation. Right since beginning, I would say we have always come up with new products. Innovation is not only a different product, it's an idea. You see, like we came up with the fairness cream for men. It was for the first time the leader in fairness cream
fair
segment was Fair and Lovely was the brand leader. So we positioned our product as especially for male. From a research it came out that, you know, 35-40% of the usage of Fair and Lovely was among the male. So that was a great innovation, and we are still the market leader in fairness cream for men.
Sure.
So similar kind, I would say, since beginning, we have always believed in new things, new ideas, and we have come up with those.
So as you said, innovation is not only about technology. Innovation is much beyond it. Yeah, of course, we use a lot of new technologies in our companies as well. In our factories, we have robots working for us. In our consumer insights area, we have this geotagging of your eyes, and if you're looking at a product for a longer time, the heat waves will tell us which part of the product you're looking at and why you are looking at. So there are many such things which are happening in our company also.
Sure.
But one thing is for sure, it has been very clearly told to us, and I would also like to convey this message to everyone who is watching your channel now, that we are a highly populated country, and it is our duty to see that people are getting jobs. Because of any technology change, the jobs which are lost, we should replace it either through some expansion or we should give them some other job. Just because to reduce your cost or to show that you are doing some automation or some technology driven things, you should not take away jobs.
Okay. In a country like India, then pricing also becomes very crucial, right? So how do you handle that question that keeps popping up quite often in terms of what should be your approach to pricing? How do you dynamically price your products?
So we are more of our products are more placed, more targeted towards the middle of India, the mass, and pricing is more sensitive there. But if your product is of good quality, if it is value for money and consistency, then people are willing to pay that little extra.
Sure.
You should not be greedy. But at the same time, the pricing should be right enough to give them, to fulfill their aspirations of using a better brand and a product.
Okay. So then speaking of, listening closely to your consumers and engaging with your consumers, for a company that's as large as you are, what would you want to tell our viewers about how you're listening closely to them? Because that's where a lot of innovation comes about.
It's very important to be in the market.
Okay.
In fact, all of us and any one of us, I think we must have at least visited 1 lakh outlets in our lifetime.
Okay.
Market visit is very important. When we started also, we used to do regularly, and today also, we talk to our marketing people also, that market may you have to keep going, because then only you will be in touch with the retailers, with the distributors, and with the consumers. Because you interact with the consumers who are coming in the retail outlet to buy different products. Then you interact with them, you come to know what they are wanting. So to be in touch with consumers, this is the best way. Lot of technology and can come up by which you can actually, research and all. But this is, I would say, is the best way of connecting with people.
Speaking of the brand then, for a brand again that's as diversified as you are of course, in the oil business, in the edible oil business, in the paper business, in the cement business, and in the FMCG space. How do you ensure that the brand is being communicated consistently, no matter who your customer is, no matter what business it is?
Though very different businesses with a very different target audience, one thing is very common in Emami, which is quality. All these products will be giving you the best quality. Number two, best service. Number three, value for money. And by best service, I mean you won't feel cheated. You will feel as if you are dealing with a fair company. So I think these are a few things.
Yeah, and you see, that is the main reason also we have given Emami name to all of these brands and all of these companies. Because we are so sure about these things, that all of the group companies will actually follow all these things.
Sure.
As you said, quality, service, value for money. And so that is why we have kept Emami name common in all the companies. And Emami will stand for whether it is in paper, cement, oil, FMCG, anywhere.
Fair enough. 90% of an entrepreneur's life cycle is spent worrying about where the money is going to come in from. And that is as far as fundraising is concerned. You are a listed company. Do you think that's essential for entrepreneurs? At what point of the life cycle, perhaps, should an entrepreneur look at listing? Should they look at, say, bank funding at, you know, the early stages? Should they look at private equity, venture capital? Is there any sort of thumb rule that you want to leave us with?
I don't think there is a thumb rule. And I don't think there can be a thumb rule. It will depend upon the size of the business, the capital which you can raise on your own, and your comfort factor. Of course, listings will have a lot, you'll have to do a lot of work.
Sure.
Corporate governance should anyways be there, in spite of being you're listed or not listed. The money, if you're borrowing from the bank, you should be equally responsible, like as if it is your money, and you should be able to run your business so that you can return the money. Mm-hmm. And similarly, if you're listed the company, then you're responsible for the shareholders. So it's all about the company, whether it is your money or somebody else's money.
Okay, fair enough. Would you say there's a thumb rule of sorts that, you know, should you be looking at listing? Should you look at fundraising?
No, you see, as he said, it basically depends upon the business, size of the business. And obviously, when a new business is started, I doubt that listing would be the right option. It all depends upon at what life cycle of the business you are in. So normally, when you are starting afresh, it's always better to start on your own. And then when you have been little success, then you can think of going for listing or PE funds or for any, like you will see in examples like startups. So all the startups, they start on their own and they take it to a certain level and then they start talking to PE investors or any such things.
Like for us also, only three of the companies are listed.
Yeah.
The others are not.
Yeah.
Maybe in time to come, we may not.
But it's there's no thumb rule to it.
Okay. That whether it has to be listed,
sure,
or money has to come through banks or through PEs, it all depends upon, and it will depend upon the person's mindset also.
Sure. Okay. My last question then, what is exciting both of you personally at the business over the next 2 to 3 years?
Yeah, you see, in coming times, I would say we are a diversified group. So, and as I said, all the individual companies are being looked after by different members and professional CEOs. So we really see a very good future in our cement, in edible oil, and in our FMCG. So these three companies, I would say, we are really looking forward.
Sure.
Where we have a lot of plans for expansion and growth. So in coming 2-3 years, I think these three companies, we are seeing
these two very different
levels.
Yeah.
Manish, Aditya, thank you both so much for your time here, the leaders of tomorrow.
Thank you again.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
That's all we could manage to pack in. If you have any feedback for us, do let us know. Our contact details coming up in just a moment. Thanks so much for watching. Have a good night.